Welcome to the Dividend Talk Podcast, episode 185. More earnings and lots of dividend hikes.
Dividend Talk is your number one podcast for all things dividend and stock market related, community oriented and with a European flavor. However, for those of you interested in delving deeper into specific topics, we also offer a premium service. This service is really centered around our newsletter featuring in-depth analysis and special subscriber requests, but also offers dividend safety stock cards, access to our beta dividend safety dashboard and an e-learning course on how to interpret the three financial statements. If you haven't become a member yet, feel free to sign up for only €119 per year. Additionally, we would like to extend a warm welcome to our latest subscribers. But let's get started. We have a jam-packed show again in which we discuss Nvidia as part of the week's news, reflect on some remarkable dividend hikes, but also touch upon dividend cuts from Enagas and Bayer. Following that, we'll delve into the earnings from Danone, Agree Realty, BASF, and Vici Properties. And as always, we'll conclude the show by addressing various questions from the community. Ready? Let's get started and enjoy the show.
Jesh, European DJ. How are you, my friend?
It's been, people may not all know, but you have been in Warsaw this weekend at my place. We had a great meetup last Saturday because we're recording on Monday morning. We had a great meetup. We had a few local listeners joining us here, going for a beer, which was very, very interesting, very nice. Like always, I learn a lot actually from the others. We had one of the guys, Daniel, also showing me something that I found like, hey, I got to try this out. Also, Michał was there. He was showing me how I can maybe use some software to save time on the dividend tax calculation and such in Poland, because there's a lot of manual work involved. And besides that, just really great conversations. Hussein was there, Victor was there, Alan was there. So it was really, really nice to meet everyone, and also us sitting together discussing a little bit, like, retrospectively, how's the year been going. We can see that there's been a lot of growth everywhere, also around the podcast. So but also thinking about what can we do better, and really like to continue focusing on our mission, right? So yeah, it's been really a blast, Derek. So cool that you joined me here.
Yeah, it was actually lovely. It was a nice weekend. I know I'm flying home soon, but it was a lovely weekend. Warsaw is a beautiful city, and as you say, we met some great people. It's just so interesting how everyone can have a similar strategy, but there's always tweaks and differences, and there's lots of thought-provoking questions. So I really enjoyed it, really took a lot away from it, learned a lot about the Polish system as well, which is sometimes a little bit different than the Irish system in terms of tax, in terms of some of the benefits that you guys have over here. So it was a great meetup. I have to say, we're recording this, our voices are a little bit more recovered, so we're good to go.
Because yesterday, actually, we recorded this one as well, but we had a lot of frequency interference, probably from phones and everything, sitting together. So we're a bit smarter today. We're doing a second try. So guys, if you wonder like why this podcast is late, that's the reason. But we, you know, it's not just we buy with conviction, we also record with conviction. So really wanted to try this again.
Yeah. Well, let's move on to some news of the week this week. Is there anything, what happened in the world? What piqued your interest?
Well, there's only one thing, I think, that really interested me. And we have to talk about this. This is Nvidia. They recorded their earnings. They reported their earnings. They recorded 22% growth, quarter over quarter, not year over year, quarter over quarter. I don't know any business doing that like that at such a mega cap. Yeah? They are up 265% from year over year. And the full year revenue now is 61 billion, up 126%, so more than doubled. I mean, this is truly amazing. And if you compare this with Intel and then Nvidia, and Nvidia really started a lot with Bitcoin, right? Where their equipment really was helping driving the whole growth of Bitcoin mining and everything, or, you know, it was the technology that was needed. If you see, I mean, it's now 1.97 trillion, almost 2 trillion market cap.
It's crazy. Absolutely crazy. But like, I know we always say don't buy into earnings because it's tough, but it, like, I think anyone who did this, they had a bit of a drop off. I think they were trading up around 700, dropped down to nearly 6, and then we had this earnings. I mean, but those numbers, it's Microsoft-esque, and it's just big numbers. So it's a shame they don't pay dividends and they're not in our world.
I think they pay a dividend. It's 0.2% or something.
Yeah, that's like no dividend to me. But I mean, look, it's a super company, and if I was Intel, I'd be really looking at them thinking, okay, these guys did their work. They spent a few years getting market share, really building up their brand, really actually doing the work to make their product superior, and it's paying off. So Intel have some catching up to do in this world, but it's interesting. This whole AI boom, AI buzzword came at the right time for Nvidia. They have the power behind them now. Their products are known for being able to handle these types of applications. So,
And then the interesting thing here is because Nvidia has been quite volatile, right? I think not too long ago it was trading at 400, then went to 200, and back to where it is now. The question I have here is, like, you pay like a 66 price to earnings here. There's a lot of growth anticipated here, but you know, I just wonder, like, can this continue like that? These are numbers that are unbelievable. And it's not like we're talking here about a small cap or a mid cap. We're talking about a whale of 2 trillion market cap. I mean, if it continues like this, it should be like 4 trillion next year.
Yeah, it's hard. In my opinion, it's hard to see that. I mean, they make hardware. It can be easy, not copied, but the technology is out there where you can probably design your own product. So I expect competitors to catch up at some point. But certainly at the moment, there's nobody close to their standard. So they're riding a bit of a wave. So,
wow, awesome. Well, it's really amazing to see this. I hope it won't end up like what we have in the dot-com bubble. I also don't think it will be, maybe from a valuation point of view, but the main difference is here, there's very hard cash flow behind it.
Yeah.
This is not a company that's making a loss. No, it's actually very profitable. So when people sometimes compare it, we need to not forget that those companies at the time weren't really making profit yet, many of them.
Yeah.
This one is. Yeah. So it's merely a matter of valuation and whether the growth justifies this valuation forward. Definitely if you look retrospectively, but forward, it's so hard to predict this one.
Exactly. Let's move on to some dividend hikes. We've got quite a few. We know that Europe is now in full swing with their earnings, lots of company releasing the results, and in turn dividend hikes. And the first one is the top company in the Noble 30 index, but it's Nestle. Their 28th consecutive year with a 1.7% increase to three Swiss
francs
per share.
Yeah, very interesting, right? So actually they have more than 60 years if you consider also a year of flat dividend in between of growth. Look, 1.7 increase, I'm not surprised. I have to look into the data, but I wouldn't be surprised if this 1.7% equates their buyback or something like that, because you did a really nice piece on Nestle not too long ago in one of our premium newsletters where you wrote like, hey guys, this is mostly fueled by buybacks, and those buybacks are mostly fueled by leveraging up the balance sheet. Yeah, we know that it's not entirely fair if you start to look at the currency exchange rate into it, then maybe it looks a little bit better. But bottom line, still the same applies. They've been heavily leveraging their balance sheet to buy back shares. And, you know, for me, this token increase, makes sense because the payout ratio isn't allowing it to grow much farther. The company is also slow growing. So, not attractive really, right?
Yeah, not at all. Anyway. You were bang on the money when I was looking at it. I could see that, look, their dividends are being increased due to buybacks, and that's been increased due to debt. So for me, 1.7% is probably what you would expect for the next 3, 4, 5 years. I did get challenged on the currency piece before, as you brought up. So, I mean, yes, you have to take that into consideration. But when you look at the facts, if you're paying your dividends with debt, it's not sustainable. So
exactly.
But then one of your favorite companies, Allianz, another insurance company, I might add, with a huge 20% hike to 13.8 euros. What do you think about that?
Well, I mean, first of all, we know that the insurance companies at the moment are very, very cash rich. Yeah, and I know they do a little bit more than insurance, but the high yield, high interest environment is also, well, it has a double-edged sword, right? From one side, they probably had to write off on some bonds in their portfolio here, but at the same time, they now have the concept of float. Yeah, so they're getting the premiums in and they can actually yield a little bit more. The solvency ratios all look good. So, I mean, generally speaking, we would have usually got a 10% hike or something like that, but they also changed their dividend policy at the same time from a 50% payout ratio to 60% payout ratio. So they want to reward shareholders a little bit more. So that's why this one is 20% higher, and I need it because we will soon get to a dividend cut here as well. So I need to have some compensation to lift it up. But yeah, very nice, very welcomed, I must say.
Yeah. And speaking of big dividend raises, we have Ferrari, ticker symbol RACE, which is probably my favorite ticker symbol ever. But they've had a huge 35%. Dividend increase to €2.44 per share. I mean, that's crazy, right?
Yeah, definitely. But it's such a nice, iconic company. One day, really, when I have too much money coming in from dividend income, I wouldn't mind having a Ferrari. I don't think it will happen in my life, but one day, maybe just renting it for a day.
Yeah.
Maybe we should do that together, right? We rent a Ferrari one time and we go, I don't know, we drive over the Costa del Sol or something like that. Yeah.
We'll host Dividend Day in real life and just rock up in a red Ferrari.
Yeah, but then yeah, no, not in the Route du Soleil in the south of France there where Monaco is and everything. We'll do it just for one day.
It'd be awesome. It'd be awesome.
Yeah.
Nice. Speaking of boring and predictable companies, BIC, BIC, so they're on the Paris Stock Exchange, ticker symbol BB on that exchange. They are paying a special dividend of €1.42, and they've also increased their dividend from 256 to 285. I mean, this kind of stuck out for me because we all know these pens, these blue pens, these black pens, they haven't changed in about 40, 50 years. It's the same style. Everybody uses them. You would think in this day and age, more people are on laptops and writing documents. You don't write as much. That where's the growth there? But I mean, that's insane numbers from that type of company. Boring and predictable. Probably what dividend growth investors like. I don't know what their history is like, by the way, in terms of dividend. But it just when I seen that increase, it just popped up.
I looked several times into BIC, and it never really attracted me. But yeah, to your point, I mean, making these pencils, I mean, I used them in the 90s. My son still uses them today. I mean, of course, bought now, but it shows something about stability. But I guess the trend is against it because people are writing less manually. But still, it's maybe worth to one time look into it a little bit deeper, maybe a stock card or something like that.
Yeah. And speaking of boring and predictable, what about one of your favorite companies, Wolterskluwer? Another 15% hike. And I think that's off the back of a double-digit hike last year as well.
Yeah, this company is just on fire. I mean, I wish I understood and saw this one earlier. I did actually 4 years ago a deep dive on it. It was clear to me. The company is just always pricey. And maybe I should have bought a little bit into this. But it's so hard to predict this because you don't expect such double-digit hikes year over year. Yeah, I mean, for such a company, it's hard to expect that.
I remember you talking about this company maybe at the beginning of the podcast, and we were saying it was overvalued then, and it was trading around $50-60 or euro, sorry, and now it's €148. Yeah. So yeah. I mean, maybe our valuation techniques were a little bit off on this one. It's still a quality company.
Well, it has been over delivering compared to what my expectations were. Simple like that.
Yeah, yeah. Easy. Danone also hiked their dividend by 5% to €2.10 per share.
Yeah, we'll talk a bit soon more about that, but it's back at the level where it was before their small dividend cut. So yeah, we'll discuss it soon in the earnings.
And we just have a couple of other ones. We have Home Depot with a 7.7% increase, which is decent. Walmart with a 9% increase, which is interesting, right? We're starting to see these staples increasing with big raises.
Yeah, Walmart is particularly really interesting because they have been having a token hike, I think, the last year or the year before. And people were wondering why, because the share price was just growing and growing and growing, right? Yeah. But I think it was mostly multiple expansion. Now they're really having confidence again and hiking a dividend of 9%, which is the biggest hike in the last 10 years for them, the last decade. So very, very interesting. And also how the company's managing it, I really like it. Yeah, they're not getting caught up in the share price hike.
No, not at all. And for me, it could be an early indication that maybe this inflationary environment might start to calm down a little bit and there's more certainty around. Because I remember Kimberly Clark was our first one where we really sat back and went, okay, there's signs of inflation happening here. They were the first to mention it. It took maybe 6, 7, 8, 9 months for it to progress through. So I'm wondering, is the reverse happening now? That they're starting to see some stabilization and can afford to give us these big hikes. So yeah, no, it's definitely intriguing me. Chubb, which is one that I think you're proud about, with a nearly a 6%, 5.8% increase, 31 years of consecutive increases as well.
Yeah, this one's interesting because they are giving small hikes, relatively small, and the payout ratio is becoming very low. But what they do, like once in a decade, they suddenly give like a 25 or 35% bump. I'm just waiting for it. And I was hoping that it would have been this year or maybe last year. They didn't. But at a certain moment, they will do it. Because look at all those insurance companies, what they are doing with the yield. Chubb is just like a very low yield from that point of view. Yeah. I'm just very proud that in 2020, in the summer when COVID was happening, that I spotted it at 100 dollars per share and I bought it because it was for me like this opportunity that, you know, like, okay, this is the moment to buy Chubb. So glad that I did.
I remember that clearly. And then three more to finish up this. We have got Prologis, ticker symbol PLD. They're a real estate investment trust, probably bigger than Realty Income as well. So they've had a 10% dividend hike. Thermo Fisher Scientific, ticker symbol TMO, had an 11% dividend hike. And Danaher, ticker symbol DHR, with a 12.5% dividend hike. I don't know about you, right? But it feels to me we're either seeing double-digit hikes are really low hikes. We're not seeing these 4, 5, 6% hikes. It's
yeah, 1%. There's not a lot.
Yeah, it's 1% or 10%. It's crazy.
Reminds
me
a little bit the statistics of the S&P 500 that most, although the average is like between 7 and 10%, but most of the years it's either they are down or they're up with more than like double digit or like 20%. But hardly ever is on the average. But the average is still the average of all those years.
Yeah.
So maybe that's the case also with the dividends. But, you know, really before we go to the next part, like I want to call out Danaher, because Danaher at the time was coming out of a transformation by the CEO at the time, who's now the CEO of General Electric. And you know my story around General Electric, but I held on to the shares for way too long, but the CEO went into there. And General Electric started to recover again. And, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if he pulls off the same trick as what he did with Danaher.
Yeah.
So the job was just probably three times more challenging in General Electric with the debt loads and everything, and the culture there and the financial engineering. But I think he's getting it back on track. And this guy, if he gets General Electric really back on track in the sense that it starts to be, you know, having tailwinds again, then this guy deserves a statue. He has done the impossible. So very interesting to see.
Yeah, nice one. So look, we have to move on to dividend cuts. And there's been two big ones in the news. No surprise, we speak about these companies on the podcast quite a bit. Well, not quite a bit, but we have spoke about them. So we've got a couple of questions. Casper, Salim, Centrino. So of course, we're talking about Enagas and Bayer. So we will speak about Enagas first. They had a 42% dividend cut, and they will be paying €1 per share from 2024 for 3 years. So 24, 25, and 26. Man, this one hurt.
Yeah, I mean, I think especially you, yeah, because I know how you've been talking to me about it. Like, they were supposed to have this dividend floor for the next 3 years, right?
Yes.
So, yeah, how do you feel about it? That's maybe more the question.
Oh man, I bought some in January. So we write in our newsletters all our transactions, and I wrote on that. Look, and to be fair, I did say, look, it's a risky bet. They're high yield. They have a weak balance sheet. I've always said though their balance sheet is weak, and they have to strengthen it. So I have no problem that they have to strengthen it. But for me, management were always very clear. They had a dividend floor in every presentation. I actually spent some time after the court going through some of the old ones to make sure I didn't miss anything. But there was I couldn't see them going back on that because they were so clear on it. They never said progressive or sustainable or, look, we have high capex coming because of other projects that it might be. They were always clear we have a dividend floor. So I trusted management, and look, it looks like I was wrong on that. I understand the reasons. The balance sheet is weak. They are now moving into this hydrogen sphere where they are going to be a similar operator as they are to gas. So they have to build that network. That takes money, it takes capex, it takes funding from the government. And of course, their balance sheet is not the strongest. We know this. So I think they were under orders maybe from the Spanish government that they have to, I think there was some regulation, they have to strengthen this balance sheet in order to get the funding and in order to be that number one in that area. So it makes sense what they have to do, but management went back on their word. And look, you still get a 6% yield on them, but my issue here now is, can I trust management? I know that these hydrogen plants are going to take 4 or 5 years to build, so they're going to start in 2026. The first one's going to be start commissioned in around 2030. So we've got some years there where there might be additional capex or money or funding needed. So what will they do? Of course, they'll cut the dividend if they need to. So for me, I can't trust them. I can't trust that dividend. I bought them. It's such a shame. I doubled down my position at 100. And so, I can't remember. I have 240 shares of them. And we bought some in January, and I don't like selling so close after buying them. But honestly, if I can't trust management, if I can't trust the word, even if I agree with what they're doing, I have to sell these guys.
Yeah, I will probably do the same. I'm thinking of selling them as well, because you know my investment case was just high yield, no growth. Yeah, like a 10% yielder. I knew the risk. Like you, I thought we'll be fine till 2026 because the CEO was very articulate, but if that was my thesis, of course, I also looked into the business. This is a good business as such, right?
Yes.
But the balance sheet was the issue. But then my whole investment case is gone, and I will find another high yield because, you know, I hate income cuts like this.
Yeah.
Yeah. But for instance, you can also get an insurance company at the moment for 8% yield.
Exactly.
With a better dividend safety profile, because our Enagas in our dividend dashboard had already like a dividend safety of 37, which means unsafe. Yes, so we knew it. So maybe it's also a lesson there to listen more. I mean, I don't really have capital loss as such, so it's not really an issue either to sell now.
Yeah.
But I think moving some of that money to insurance is probably better. And, you know, they always ask me over the years, why don't you have utilities in your company? Well, this is the reason. I buy a utility, they cut the dividend. I always have this with utilities. It's something that I maybe just don't understand well enough.
Yeah, exactly. Look, I was planning on reassessing and probably selling them in 2026 anyway, because I expected them to not have that dividend floor after that. It's just a shame they did it before that. I have a small capital loss, but I think the dividends I've received over time I kind of counteract that. So I'm not too concerned. I'm only really concerned about what management said and what they did, which counteracts, they oppose each other. So it's time to move on. But hey, there's a second, I mean, it's a bad week for you. There was a second company, Bayer, cut their dividend by 95%. I mean, look, from my perspective, I'm not surprised that litigation. We did a show, it must be one of our first shows, I can't remember, but the worst acquisition in history was around Monsanto and their product Roundup, which has been nothing but trouble. And now 95% on top of the capital loss from the share price. How do you feel about that?
I mean, honestly, I'm happy that they're cutting the dividend as such, because this was up in the air already. With another guy on Twitter, we're often talking about Bayer, but more as a joke, as a parody here. So I have a few shares still in this company. I'm keeping them actually, right? Because I moved them already like 2 years ago from dividend growth to a value play. Well, the value play has not been really working out well so far. You know, one of those turnaround stories that I'm reducing in my portfolio. Yeah. And I've got only Intel and Bayer, I think, left as turnaround stories here. So, but you know, if you look at the PE ratio at the moment, it is so low. Yeah, because now they are having these settlements coming in. So they need to do those kind of one-offs, which will be a continual one-off for the next few years if they don't settle, if they are not able to settle. So these are now more fines, I guess, or court orders. So I have an expectation that once they get to the point that they can really, you know, with make a deal with the government in America, that this company may pop really quickly, very high. So, but I have written it off already mentally, and the dividend as well. So I was never counting on this dividend anymore. So, yeah, you know, but there are also learnings to be made here, right? And this is not new. I learned that I have this 10% of the portfolio where Bayer is part of, that I'm better in value plays that are technology related, like where Google dips or Facebook dips, than that I am at where there's a broken story. So I don't think I will invest quickly again in broken stories and use this 10%, which is now, by the way, I made it 5% because, you know, I don't need it to be a lot of money there.
Yeah.
There, it's just to nurture my inner need. And but yeah, I've been doing this already over time. Less turnaround, less some, and more of those tech companies that I believe in.
Particularly when there's litigation involved. That's
For
me, that's the key.
And because of the Bayer learning, I was quick to act on 3M. I still have a few shares in 3M, but it has been reduced so much. And redeployed elsewhere where it's hopefully compounding properly and not being dead money for the next 5 years.
Yeah. Okay, earnings season is still in full swing, and we've got a mix here of European and we've got some real estate investment trusts. So you might kick us off. BASF, we call them BASF. I've been told it's you have to say it every letter singly, so I'm trying to take that on board. But you had a look at their earnings. What did you see?
Well, first of all, it's very, very interesting. You know what the headline is in the news? And based on the press release from BASF themselves, it is like BASF's financial strength supports proposed stable dividend of €3.40 per share for the 2023 business year. If you see such a headline, you know that there's nothing worth reading further there, because it must be a shit show. And honestly, it is from that point of view. No surprises, because I must applaud this company for how they are guiding, how they are also committed to the dividend if they say that they are committed. Yeah. So I think the CEO does all the right things from a communication point of view. They are just very much struggling, right? They have this Ludwigshafen, which in Germany, which is just really struggling because of high input costs and such. They have now cost savings programs and everything. I think you don't want to be an employee in this area. I think it's like a butcher there. We say in the Netherlands, Woensdag Haaksdag, which means something like a meat love day. You know, you're being grinded. But listen to this. Yeah, the free cash flow that they generated was 2.7 billion, minus 18.5%. And they're predicting, and for as an outlook for 2024, a cash flow between 100 million and 600 million due to expected temporarily higher capex.
Yeah,
this capex that they are talking about is a result of their investments, for instance, in China. So if they are making around 8 billion and forecasting around 8 billion of operating cash flow, and they need to invest at least 6 billion already in capex, then not a lot of money is left. Yeah, and they expect these investments this year and next year, and then they expect the capex level to be between 3 and 4 billion. So, you know, this puts pressure on the dividend, because if I now tell you what the dividend was in 2023, that was 3 billion, yeah, the dividend payment. So already they're paying out more than they can afford. And they've also had on the balance sheet some declining in their asset value because of some write-offs, right? Write-offs are a result of reassessing the value of their business and the earnings power of their business. And you know, if you do write-offs, it always travels via the equity, the shareholder equity, because you can't do it from the debt, because that needs to be hard cash. You need to pay it down to the bank.
Yeah.
So this means that the debt equity is rising. They still have a good credit rating, right? So I'm not too worried about it today, but I'm worried about it next year. So for me, I honestly expect them to cut the dividend next year. So what I'm doing with BASF as well, I'm aiming to sell it. I may wait till the dividend still gets paid, yeah, to collect this nice high yield. But then I may also put a put option in place to preserve my capital. Otherwise, I will just sell it one of these days and redeploy the money elsewhere. It was also here always a little bit like a higher yield income play, also knowing that this business is cyclical.
Yeah.
So over time, you know, but they've always been committed to dividend. But this cash flow impact, which is not a single year, which will be 2 years and probably even 3-4 years, It's just too much. I don't think the company can afford it, and they would do well to cut the dividend.
For me, it's a similar story to what Enagas are doing. And we can see the CapEx is rising significantly. They say it'll reach its peak next year, 2024, and then it tapers off slightly in 2025 and then 40% in the preceding 2 years. But still, look, they still have to put that up. The dividend, I think management are really giving us pointers here. Look, we're going to have to cut this next year, and this is our cash flow. We're really struggling. We need to invest in China. We have a strategy there. We have a new site there. That's where our money needs to go. And then maybe after that, we can increase it again. So I'm like you. I have shares in them. I am going to wait for that dividend. I mean, that's the thing with European companies. You wait all year for that dividend. So it'd be a shame to sell them now. I don't think there's too much risk with that this year, but. Yeah, I'd be looking to sell them after. I think June. I think they paid a dividend May or June. So I'd be looking to sell them after that. And look, I like what management is doing here. I really do. But as you said, we need that income, and learning from Enagas and learning from all our previous experience, I think I want to get out of this before there's anything.
Yeah, exactly. Because usually share price will follow because the dividend yield often puts also a little bit of a floor in the share price.
Okay, moving on to maybe one of the real estate investment trusts, and Agree Realty is one of the ones I looked at. I analyzed this company recently. It's a really, really nice company, often known as the little brother or little sister of Realty Income, and for good reason. I mean, they follow pretty much the same, well, not the same, but a similar strategy. You would argue, you don't even have to argue, Agree Realty do have better grade tenants. I think 75% or close to 75% are investment grade, which gives a little bit of comfort, a little bit of safety. They are a smaller company than Realty Income. So in terms of growth, there's more opportunity. It's probably easier for them. It doesn't take as much money or funding or even properties to push the needle a little bit higher for Agree Realty than Realty Income. So they're quite a compelling investment at the moment. But look, the 2020 year was solid, I would say. It's been a tough year for real estate in terms of interest rates. But as predicted, they said they were going to grow 2-3%, which is exactly what they did. But what they're doing is they are still investing in lots of companies. They spent $1.19 billion investing into 282 properties. They did this locking in a 6.9% yield. And again, it's mainly in investment grade tenants over 11.3 years is their approximate. So there's some level of certainty there. The balance sheet is actually quite strong. I like their balance sheet. It's very liquid. They got $1 billion of total liquidity. They got some cash on hand. Their adjusted funds from operation has grown, as I said, 3%. They're predicting the same for next year as well. And they've got a 99.8% lease, I mean tenants leased. So overall, I think it's quite strong. Their dividend growth is very strong. They increased it last year. They pay monthly, so we all like monthly dividends. But look, a lot to like from that. What I will say is they are funding these properties through share dilution. I think they've added 25% to their shares over the last year, so which is quite a lot. But I mean, the growth is still there. They've plenty of opportunities. I really like what they did this year.
Yeah, and what I also really like is there for the payout ratio, right? They made, what is it, an AFFO or FFO around $4, a dividend around $3, so 75% payout ratio, which is really good for a real estate investment trust. For me, it has less risk in the portfolio, you know, and more opportunities for growth because the incremental addition of new tenants is making a bigger impact, I think, to Agree Realty, because we have seen that with Realty Income, they now need to make those billion-dollar deals at once, and it's really hard even to understand those deals at times. So it makes it a bit harder. But we have to say, like, Realty Income bought did like a sale-back lease sale-back with Decathlon, and for our people that are from America that are listening, which still a significant amount of here, Decathlon is one of those, I would say, special brands or retail shops in sport goods. They sell everything. So usually the competition here is Intersport, and those shops, they where you get your gear for basketball, football, the Nike gear and everything running. But Decathlon has all the niche stuff as well. Like if you need anything from, you know, let's say table tennis, hiking, bike materials, summer stuff, ballet, everything, you get it there. Yeah, so and there's a very value for money oriented shop. Yeah, so even the Nike brands are usually the lower end brands that you see there. But for you and I, with family, with kids that grow really quickly, and they need a new size each year, but maybe use it also once or twice, this is perfect. This is really perfect, this shop. So I buy a lot there every time when we go camping or when the kids need something, because I know it's not worth it investing in Jordans or whatever it is for them at this moment in time.
Yeah. I mean, Realty Income, I mean, one of their biggest risks, and we spoke about it before, was around our international expansion, the moving into areas that are, I would say, not their circle of competence, or traditionally not their circle of competence. Not to say they don't have intelligent people working in these areas, but it's not traditionally what they do.
Yeah.
I have liked what they've done so far. I do like the acquisition they did in Las Vegas. I do like some of the acquisitions they're doing in Europe. But the concern is that they need to take these types of risks to continue to grow the company. And eventually they might start picking up substandard lets and tenants just to try and get that growth. Whereas Agree Realty are so small, they can stay, and I'm going to use the word, they can stay more laser focused, but they can stick to their strategy where they're really comfortable, where they're really strong. They have a good track record. So they can stick to that. And it's, for me, it's a lot easier for them to work in that area. They know it really well. So it's less risky. And plus, as I said, having a higher standard of tenant, 75% are investment grade, does make a real difference. So yeah, I mean, both are really good companies. You don't need to own one or the other. I mean, I have both. I'm happy with both. I just see more growth potential in Agree Realty.
Same here. Good. Hey, then I think we have to talk one time about Danone again. Many people know us from the beginning of the podcast as specifically me being a Danone fanboy.
Yes.
Yeah. Then COVID hit us. There was no water sales, right? Because they sold a lot of water at the restaurants everywhere, those little bottles of Evian, and that just got all crushed at sales. But we're behind COVID, back to normal, so the company also have some tailwinds there. But generally speaking, I think this has been, again, a bit of a turnaround story, not as a broken stock as such, but more like what we see with Unilever, a bit like flat earnings. The former CEO was there, who was very, very busy with everything related to sustainability. And I think he forgot to focus also on the shareholders. And I must say, I like this new CEO. He's now 2 years in the job. When he came, I kept the shares from Danone because I saw his track record at I think a Swiss company around producing chocolate or something like that. And I thought, like, okay, this guy might have it. Yeah, smaller company goes to a bigger company, but if he can do the same, we'll be in good shape. And I think that's happening here. But you need to look at the underlying factors, not yet at the top line results, because top line, they have been growing the sales with 7% effectively because of price hikes. Yeah, volume has been flat. It comes all from price hikes. They were able to pass on the price to the consumer, which is interesting because, you know, I buy a lot of this Alpro, not Alpro, but let's say vegan milks.
Yeah.
And Alpro is the main brand there. But in our shop here, Biedronka, they are at the same, in the same shelves space with the alternatives, which are like, I think I pay 11 or 12 zloty for Alpro and I pay like 6 zloty for the alternative. I'm buying mostly the alternative. You know, I'm a dividend growth investor, probably a bit more frugal. It's like Starbucks, you don't buy the coffee, you own the brand. Yeah. And that's the same here, but I usually buy them at discount because I must say, after drinking this stuff already for years, Alpro has by far the best quality.
Yeah.
If you want to make a barista foam or something like that, you need to have the Alpro really. So, but it's just the pricing, and that's why I'm also concerned. I mean, they can continue hiking it, but I think it will just push more people to the alternative brands because the cost of production is really not expensive for this stuff. Yeah. What is it? It's a bit of wheat with water. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's what we're talking about here. Look, if you look at the earnings, they will say recurring EPS of 340, 350 versus the accounting EPS of €1.50. Reason for this big delta is they had to entirely write off their Russia business. So it's a one-off impact. I don't think there will be a war each year where they need to step out of the country. So I'm very much okay with this one. But it also means that the company is, trading relatively attractively from that point of view. Specifically, when I see that the company starts to grow on an underlying basis a little bit, they're just getting a little bit their mojo back. And I think it will still need 1 or 2 years, but what the company is doing with giving more authority locally and such to and also more sales focus, I think is a good thing.
Yeah.
And that's why they have been able to propose a dividend of €2.10, because it's very easily covered. They claim to have a record year of free cash flow of 2.6 billion as well, which is more than their net income again. So this dividend is very well covered. And yeah, happy with what I'm seeing here. Happy that I held onto the shares in this case. Yeah, and then maybe one more thing. When I say underlying, what I'm talking here is really about their return on investments are increasing now.
Yeah,
and this is one of those early signals that are really important for me to see. It means that the business, the company is getting more return on the initiatives that they are doing here.
Yeah.
And that's a good thing.
Yeah, I have to say that CEO has impressed me. He came in, he kind of had a look around, did his water tour of Danone, really got a feel for the company and came back to us and said, okay, 2022 is our foundational year. This is the lowest we're going to be and we're going to build from that. And he has started to show that he can do that. I would like to see that volume mix and price mix a little bit more spread. I don't like when I see volume is actually down nearly 0.5%, and then the rest of it is made up by price, because that can't continue forever, because like you said, there's only so much brand will get you, and when the alternative is that much cheaper, sometimes you will sacrifice quality for that. So I would like to see that, but I mean, he's predicted 3-5% growth like for like sales, so it doesn't look like they'll be hiking prices that much, but I'd like to just see that volume a little bit better. But I mean, strong results from them. There's a little bit of a learning here, because I kind of forgot about Danone, I have to say. I know during COVID they had a difficult time. They haven't yet really recovered from that. And when the new CEO came in, I said, look, I'll give him 12 months and see. And I actually forgot about the company, and they're starting to turn around. So yeah, maybe there's a lesson in there as well. But yeah, solid results, and we can start to be Danone cheerleaders again. Awesome. So the last company then is one of my favorite companies at the moment, which is Vici Properties. We know that they are heavily involved in Las Vegas. They own the majority of the Las Vegas Strip, so that's all the hotels there. I'm going to Las Vegas in August, so I'm supporting them. I'm doing my best to support them. But look, they've got really, really strong numbers. The actually CEO says they're on the upper end of the S&P 500 in terms of REITs, in terms of their growth. And look, that's clear to see. They grew their AFFO by 29.1%. So look, I think the catalysts are clear. What they are also doing, which I like, is they're expanding outside of Las Vegas. I mean, you can only buy up so much of Las Vegas and then it'll run out of space. So they are entering into Canada and other places, and also financing in the UK. But look, really, really strong numbers. It's a young company. They've increased their dividend every year over the last 6 years. There's definitely some strong growth there for the next five, six years. So I'm quite happy with this company. It's what, 5-6% yield. They've given some decent hikes. I'm expecting another 5-7% dividend hike from them this year. But really, really good numbers. And look, if they can continue investing, they invested what, 3.6 billion, or so, 2.5 billion, and keep growing that funds from operation double digits, we're in for some strong returns over the next few years.
Yeah. Very interesting business, and I don't own it, right? I'm practicing here the joy of missing out, but mostly because, you know, I struggle with the understanding of why would anyone go to a casino. But then again, you called me out the other day about, well, but hey, EDGI, you own Evolution Gaming,
yeah,
which is really, of course, a little bit hypocritical maybe from me. But Evolution Gaming, I guess I have a little bit more affinity with because it's a digital business, and yeah, I understand technology, I understand IT technology. And that's where I'm really impressed, because I can see people doing this from home, therefore, and such. And I can see that this business will continue to grow. But yeah, probably also the casino space. I've just been in America a few times in a casino. I don't understand why people are throwing coins in this stuff and why they're not throwing those coins into dividend stocks. But you could apply the same to the clients of Evolution Gaming. So yeah, it's one of those things where it doesn't make sense, but somehow I don't get this feeling for Vici. And, you know, that's what I also feel about, right? And it's hard to learn this, because in the past I had some FOMO, right? When someone was saying, oh, this, I was also probably looking into it to really consider buying it. But with this one, if I don't have a feeling for it, I just, okay, enough, let's move on, right?
Yeah, I 100% agree, because as we always say, you cannot borrow conviction. And if something turns on this, I can own up and make my mistakes. But if you say I bought this because you made it sound so pretty and so good, I mean,
exactly,
it's not a good thing.
I'd rather buy some more Enagas, right?
Yeah. But look, I had some experience in this world. I was, as I mentioned before, I was doing some sort of trading. You can trade on the exchanges in betting. So what they're doing is they're selling you that experience, that dream. You can win big, but it's, even if you don't win, you're happy to be there and just enjoying it. So that's what they're selling. People like that. So I'm a big fan of them. Okay, we'll move on to some of the listeners' questions. And we'll start with the first one, which is going to be our guest next week. You spoke about Evolution Gaming, the Wolf of Harcourt Street. He's been on our podcast before. He has a really, really good Substack where he goes deep into such companies. So he's going to come on and give us his expertise about Evolution Gaming next week. But he's asked me, how does Warsaw compare to Waterford? And for those that don't know, Waterford is in the southeast, I should say, of Ireland. I would say Warsaw is quite more diverse in terms of the building structure. I mean, you've got, I mentioned this to you before, you've got old buildings, you've got new buildings, you've got American style, European style, kind of Soviet style, and all mashed together. And it looks so pretty and so much greenery. I'm looking outside, I know it's autumn here and there's no leaves on the trees, but you can see so many trees here that I can imagine in spring that it's beautiful. But the people are friendly, the cities are clean, the transport is on time, it's predictable, it's actually really good. I can't always say the same about Waterford, but it feels like a bigger city here. There's a vibe, you just get a vibe from a place. So I quite like it. It's a nice place. I can see why you live here. It's a fabulous place.
Yeah, but I would also say that your opinion is a little bit blended from Saturday night after a dozen of vodka shots.
Well,
yeah, so everything looks prettier after vodka.
Yeah, well, luckily I've seen a small bit before them vodka shots. But Alex has asked us about investments that have a time horizon of several decades, right? So does it make sense to pay attention to value? So if you think of companies like Alimentation Couche-Tard, Ferrari, Microsoft, they are almost never cheap, but does it make sense to pay attention to price?
Well, you know, and Wolterskluwer, another one, right? That
yes.
We just spoke about. So, Jain, I'm going to say yes, no. So I understand that looking at the price from a multiple point of view alone, there's something really good into what he suggests here. What I would suggest in that case, if you're following that line of thought, look at start thinking and make a prediction about the EPS, the earnings per share, let's say 20 years from now. Yeah, what do you think it will be? If it's today 1 euro, do you think it will be 5 euro, 6 euro? Then look at the current price you pay for that as a multiple. Let's say it's a 50 multiple, so you pay 50 euro. And if it will be 5 euro, you say, okay, it will be 20 multiple by then. So that means like the company will grow into its earnings by multiple deceleration, let's say. So it will be 100 euros. And then think about what is the return on investment that you get over those years, right? Make the CAGR formula here. And maybe then it will tell you like, okay, I don't know, it will give me a 6% return on investment. And then ask yourself, are you happy with this? Yeah, maybe you expect it to be at a multiple of 30 by that time. Maybe that gives you a 10% return on investment. Are you happy by that? That's mostly the question. So I think you can't, when you're buying, you can't, and you shouldn't, you shouldn't release yourself from doing a business analysis. If you don't do a business analysis and just buy it based purely on price and sentiment and thinking like this company is on fire, I think you will often have a high risk of getting disappointed. But if you do the business analysis, do a forecast of what you think the company can do in earnings, and then just look at it, because yeah, you might not get the 20% return if it would be on a lower valuation, but if 10% is still good enough, then go for it. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, look, there's a case for pound wise, penny foolish in terms of if your valuation is 10, 20, even 30 euro dollars off, maybe it might not make sense to hold out. Okay. But I always use Cisco as a good example here. I mean, in the late 90s, early 2000s, around 98, they were at their peak and they were sort of like Microsoft at the time and the euphoria around them, and they were trading at really high valuations. And it just fell off a cliff. And it took, I don't even think they've reached that price yet. Now, yeah. Dividends included, you might have made your money back maybe 10, 15 years later. But it's still, you know, I think valuation still matters. I still think it matters. Just look at Ferrari and their multiples. And man, I just could not do that. I could not buy it. Casper has asked us about our projected annual dividend income. How do you calculate it? Do you calculate it based on your forecasted dividends or your current dividends?
I do it on my current dividends here, because yeah, that's the real projected annual dividend income.
Yeah.
Because forecast, that means like if I look backwards, then of course it's less because I'm making new money or deploying new money. But only things I know 100% sure. So, for instance, I already changed the Enagas in my portfolio, and I saw that my paddy dropped a little bit, right? So, that's the impact of it.
Yeah, I do the exact same, current dividends, and work from there. You know where you stand then, because if I'm making an estimation, my dividend, my paddy could be 20%, when in reality, right now, it's not at that. So,
yeah.
Abraham has asked us about switching from investing on a monthly basis when the salary arrives to investing on a quarterly basis. He's thinking about this because of transaction costs and the frequency and maybe the time that comes with it. I don't think there's a hard and fast rule here. I mean, there's nothing stopping you from investing annually, quarterly, bi-monthly, monthly, whatever works best. If you're thinking about transaction costs, I'm going to make the assumption that your portfolio is relatively small and your transaction size is relatively small, because transaction costs are cheaper now than they were before. But if they are having an impact on your portfolio, then it might make sense to move that out to quarterly. But it's personal preference.
As long as it doesn't lead to timing the market.
Yes.
Yeah, then be consistent by each first day of the quarter or something like that to avoid yourself getting trapped into timing the market.
Yeah.
That's what my suggestion be, because if you go quarterly, you have also more risk of buying at the wrong moment. Yeah, you get a little bit less efficient from a dollar cost averaging strategy. But still, in the long run, it shouldn't really matter.
And you've kind of triggered a thought in me. Earnings are quarterly, so there's a little bit more volatility around that. So do you wait until after earnings? And then, there's a bit to think about. But honestly, I just think it's personal preference. Once you're not, as you said, time in the market, either one works. Joe's Broke Dude has asked us about investing in low dividend, high growth stocks instead of medium growth or high dividend stocks. What's the point? Why would you invest in low dividend and high growth?
So generally, my screen is at 2.75% yield. But I bought, for instance, some Evolution Gaming, which was a lower yield and high growth. And I think it deserves a space in my portfolio. Let's say maybe up to 20-25%. Why? I've got also a lot of high yields and I've got this medium yield, and I think the optimum is a combination of the three of them.
Yeah.
And why is this? If you think about 20 years from now, this lower growth, low yielding stock with higher growth might start giving me really the dividend hikes by that time. Yeah. And what we see is that high yield, low growth will stay like that for a long time. And this is nice when you're in the accumulation phase, because you can reinvest those dividends. But once you're at retirement, it means probably that you have a higher risk of a dividend cut, first of all. Plus, you have a higher risk that you won't be beating inflation with the growth numbers.
Yeah.
And that's why I think you need to have a bit of a bit of both. You need some growth. You need some earnings growth in your portfolio, because in the end, dividend growth is what we look for, because the income, but it can only be funded by underlying earnings growth. So you need to have this in your portfolio.
I guess the theory would be that if you have a low dividend and high growth, it's probably in theory safer than maybe a high dividend, even if it's low growth. And you could take Enagas as an example. In theory, that's not always true. As I said, earnings and cash flow have to come into it, but maybe that's the theory. But yeah, I think having a mixture of all three is probably optimal for you. You have to diversify your portfolio. Value and dividend investor. All high growth dividend stocks are overvalued with PE ratios greater than 20. How much are you guys paying attention to valuations? What is the margin of safety and downside protection?
Yeah, so we it's a little bit in line with the questions we just had, right?
Yeah.
So look, when you only look at the PE ratio, you're missing the component of growth. Yeah. So PE doesn't tell the whole story. Sometimes it's worth to pay for 30 PE if the growth is there. It's not happening a lot. That's why I usually don't want to pay for more than 20 PE. But the price to earnings for me is more like a litmus test. Sometimes it's not even reliable if you look at the information, because we just spoke about a one-off in Danone.
Yeah.
Then it looks like the company is trading now at a 40 PE. Yeah. Makes no sense. So, but the growth component is needed. And that's why I'm much more of a fan of discounted cash flow analysis, because with that, you make an estimate of the future cash flows based on your growth assumptions and discount them to what it's worth today. You have the growth assumptions in there. This is key here. So generally speaking, and my stock screener is also around not more than a 20 PE, but it doesn't mean you can pay a 30 PE and still do well. And for me, Evolution Gaming was a really good example there that I bought.
Nice one. Lisa has asked about your annual report for 2023. Where is it?
Yeah, it will hopefully come soon. I had for our premium subscribers, I had to focus really on the three financial statements course, which is now released. So our members can now take this course. where they learn a bit more about the income statement, how to analyze it, and also the balance sheet and the free cash flow or the cash flow statement. So it consumed me a lot of time. In the first week of January, I was sick, so I was able to do all the calculations, and then I spent my time at that. That was the window of opportunity that I always used to write the annual report, because after that, all the routine stuff kicks in.
Yeah.
But I think maybe this week I will get to some proper writing here, so hopefully with the ability to release it.
JC asked us about Nestle and Danone, and we spoke about Danone and a little bit about Nestle, but honestly, I haven't looked at their earnings, really. I don't know if you have.
We just spoke about Danone, right? And then about Nestle, I haven't really looked into them. I'm not so bothered about Nestle at this moment.
Yeah, me too. What about Iberdrola? Have they lived up to your expectations, and also your thoughts on the Mexico deal?
So yes, they have lived up to my expectations. First of all, their earnings grew by 11%, 10.7%, which is amazing for this company, right? And that's why they are also growing the dividend with the same rate, 10.8%, and they will pay a dividend of 55 cents per year now. I'm amazed by this. So why Dividend Gardener is asking probably is also because I did a full article about it, a deep dive. The company surprised me a lot, very strong. It's playing in all those areas where governments are investing in climate change. So definitely a good one. And like Maciej also asked, right, what are my thoughts on the Mexico deal? Look, I'm not surprised by this one. And I will write you what I wrote and the biggest risk I saw for Iberdrola, right? So the biggest risk is governmental privatization or private exclusion. Iberdrola operates in a heavily regulated industry, and protective policies are always around the corner. As an example, Mexico has recently reformed its electricity industry law, which prioritizes public energy over private energy. In other words, Iberdrola is not allowed to grow there out of national interests. Of course, the company has taken this to court, but it has yet to be seen what outcome it is able to achieve. And now, literally a few weeks later, we read about this Mexico deal. For me, this is very interesting. So what they have done, they agreed to sell 55% of their Mexican business to this private entity. The issue is here that I don't really know what the impact is on their earnings power. I need to dive a bit deeper into this here before I really round up my conclusion. But I think generally speaking, the company, as how I've learned to know them, wouldn't hike a dividend with 11% if they are not sure that they can cover it. But Mexico, there was a high margin business. Yeah. So to find back that similar high margin may be a challenge for the company.
Yeah, also shows the benefit of doing your homework. I'm reading the risk as you wrote it, and yeah, you are pretty much spot on with that. Terry Spoonface has asked us about legal and general, but I think it's fair to say they're the main topic of our premium letter this week. It was probably the most requested stock we've got, and probably because we speak about them, they seem kind of undervalued in terms of share price, and they have a high dividend. So I know you did a deep dive on that, so I think we might leave this question and come back to it another time, give our members some time to digest what you have wrote on it. But Mayek has asked us, do you think AI computer adoption could have a noticeable impact on HPQ's performance in the coming years?
Most likely, but I think what will have the most impact on the earnings in the upcoming 1-2 years is that there will come a renewal cycle again. Remember that in 2020, their earnings were like berserk. They were able to buy so much back as well that they reduced, I think, the share count by 8 or 15% in a single year because everyone had money left. The government also was sponsoring a lot of that with the checks that they were writing in America. So many people bought equipment, myself included. But actually, just a few weeks ago, I bought a new, my own desktop and why? Because my laptop was starting to become slower and I was doing the heavy work on that. So I decided now to switch to desktop to extend the lifespan of my laptop. But I mean, most people would choose a laptop. So I really expect in the company itself as well that people start buying laptops again. Yeah. Because now 4 years further, the lifespan out of warranty And that's what I think will really make sure that the earnings recover and the cash flow recovers. And if then on top of that, the AI, which means that data scientists will need more powerful laptops to do the work, there's a higher margin probably on that, then that's for me a cherry on the cake. But this is a buyback machine. This is really a buyback machine.
Yuki has asked us about Granges. It's a Swedish stock, ticker symbol GRNG. What about its dividend yield and growth potential? And look, I'll be honest, and I think you're the same, we did not know much about this company. But typically when we get this type of question on a company, we look at their dividend history first, just to get a sense of what that's like and see if it's a company we would like to look at a little bit further. What I noticed was between 2014 to 2018, yes, there was decent growth there. They cut it in 2019 and they still haven't got back to the levels of before that cut. So they've had 3 years since that and they're still below them levels. Their payout ratio is quite low. It's usually around 40%, which suggests to me that their earnings or the cash flow has not recovered yet either. So it didn't quite interest me enough to look into them a little bit further. It just seemed a little bit choppy. There could definitely be potential there. But honestly, I don't have the time to look into this type of company. There's plenty of others that I like a lot better, but that's what I thought on it anyway.
Yeah, same here.
And then the last question then is from Humberto, and he's asked us about Equinor as a dividend stock.
Yeah, Equinor is very interesting. So for people that don't know this company, I believe it's a Norwegian oil and gas company, pretty much like Total Energies and Royal Dutch Shell. Yes, I consider the dividend growth stock. They follow a similar pattern as Shell, cutting the dividends during COVID and then recovering again. Actually, their dividend is now larger than what they were paying before COVID, while Shell still has to recover from that. So kudos to Equinor. They're also paying really big special dividends as well right now, while, for instance, a company like Shell is buying back shares. I leave it up to the listener what they prefer at that moment in time when they have additional cash. What I would like to say is here, like when you think about this, I mean, I'm biased towards Shell because I've been studying the company much more than a company like Equinor. I looked a few times into Equinor, but I think they follow a similar profile. So I think energy and oil and gas deserves a spot in the portfolio. There's more than the US ones, yeah. With the European ones may be a bit more favorable when you think about the changes that are happening in society and the need for more climate-friendly solutions. So for me, if you compare the two, make a choice, I would say. But I see Equinor generally as a dividend growth company, and I understand why they had to cut the dividend in 2020 during COVID because of the supply shock that was there in the industry. And in this case, Equinor made already up for it, which is something to applaud management for.
Yeah. Nice one. Again, thanks to everyone for all your questions. As always, much, much appreciated. That was the last one, so it's the end of the show. Just a reminder, we've got Wolf of Harco Street next week talking about Evolution Gaming. So that should be a good one. So if you stuck around this long, thanks so much for listening, and we'll see you all next week.
Remember, both of us at Dividend Talk are not certified financial specialists through formal education. We are just two guys sharing our journey for inspiration and entertainment purposes. Hence, this is not investment advice. Although we do our best, we can't promise that the information discussed is always correct, nor appropriate for you or anybody else. We always recommend that you do your own due diligence and be accountable for your own choices. As we always say, you can't borrow conviction from others. Last but not least, by listening to our podcast, you agree to hold us harmless from any ramifications, financial or otherwise, that occur to you as a result of acting on information provided in this podcast.